Allow me to continue from where I left off in the last lecture. The last lecture was about a very important thing, that is about the connectors. As I have explained to earlier, all any circuit or anything will end up invariably with manageable small sub assemblies. So, I will start with something which is directly connected here, which is this wireless receiver. You notice that inside the equipment you have several subsystems and all that. One or two things stick out of it. One of them is this microphone, and then we have a very firm connector here, then we have this antenna, and then you also see we have several switches and all which are connected here. Same thing here, some of them are something which you set all the time. Something, these are all press ones, power and then synchronize and so on. So, the lecture started with several types of connectors where subsystems are to be attached together. So, if you see the attachment of various things here, both sides you have a connector termination. If you see the, this is a little like, I am sure you have seen it in several places, a little like your headphones are cordless, I am sorry, hands free. So, this whole thing comes in a plug. It is called a 3.5 mm banana, I do not know why it is called a banana plug. On this side there is a receptacle, and then it explained to you about various things related to this. The thing now changes over. If you can look at the monitor, I left you here last time saying we have this female machine pin headers snapped apart into smaller sections. And then later on I left you here saying we have various types of connectors, crimp type cables. The advantage of the crimp type cables is you have small socket pins which are either pre-inserted or you take them out, attach it to a cable and then push it into these headers. You see here there is a small lug here which ensures that it does not come out, especially when you put it here. Advantage is it gives a fantastic positive connection, and then you can have a rating of your choice. Disadvantage is, however, it is a very elaborate, time consuming and expensive procedure, meaning all of them come in a reel or in a roll, and then individually you have to take this cable and then ensure that everything sits perfectly inside. In spite of machine operations and all that, cutting the cable to length still is an issue. Sometimes we may need about this much length. This is approximately 400 mm. Sometimes we may just need a little less, only 390. 400 will end up with kinks, and if you make it very short, 380. It may not reach and may lead to cable tension. So, in general, especially in places like inside our system units and all that, we have ended up with this insulation displacement. Ribbon cables. Main thing of the ribbon cable is that the ribbon is flat to start with. So, routing it and making it and all that, it comes relatively easy. There are little, a few advantages and disadvantages. Advantage being, it being flat, as I had explained to earlier, if you just push one of these onto this flat cable, the pins or the sockets are, I mean generally in this case it is the sockets, because pins are usually mounted on the other side PCB, it automatically cuts through the insulation. If you have insulation like this, this thing will go inside and then make sure that it meets perfectly. Probably it is offset and so on. So if you see here, it has including this polarizing tabs, and depending on the current density, usually two row are convenient. Further down, if you come, this is one way of attaching known things, but you will notice that a lot of times these connectors cannot be permanent. I have given you an example of the car cable harness that you have inside the car. So it is a beautiful cable harness, and then if you remember, I mean, just ignore the very old models, things over the last maybe 15-20 years, most of the things that you are likely to add, including loudspeakers, not the boom boxes you attach at the back, and then several of the things including power windows, including lot of these, what you call audio and all this, pre-crimped harnesses are already installed. And generally, as much as possible, they try to, at least within one category of equipment, they try to make them interchangeable. So if you were to buy another audio system, you just need to pull it out of the console which is there on the dashboard and then push the other one, and miraculously the connectors meet and we are in business. That is why I have used a very, what do you call, loaded word. Reality is things have been changing and it is not as easy as it sounds, but still a good attempt is made. At any one time, generally a lot of people don't like what is supplied by the original car manufacturer. They would like to have their own choice. So if you buy an audio system, the one that is fitted in the car, generally people don't like it because they would like a preference. Now in this case, we will end up with having temporary connectors. It may be desirable to be able to connect bare unterminated wire to a circuit. Only the other day we installed a huge deep well pump. So the deep well pumps come with their own cables, and depending on the type of installation, we need to connect bare unterminated wires which come from the well outside into the box. There, the smallest have been these screw terminals for a good solution for this. They are also good for situations in which a connection should be capable of supporting multiple different connecting devices. So you would have probably seen it behind your audio speakers and all that. You have a small opening, then you have something to, what do you call, loosen it a little. You have an opening, you have something to make the opening, and then inside you can put more than one or two wires. And in the case of power connectors, there are what are called lugs, which are terminated, which need to be assembled here. Downside of screw terminals is that they can come undone fairly easily, leaving a bare wire waving around in your circuit. Dab of hot glue can address this. So this is a matter of detail, how to prevent this thing here. So if you go down, you see here tremendous, what do you call, variety of these connectors are available now. You see, one part of it is the one that goes into the printed circuit board. The other part of it is where, this is the one I was talking to you about. If you open this screw a little, we can put anything into that circuit. So we have, I will see if I can punch up the Phoenix things you have seen here. These are the typical terminal blocks. You have seen that. It's a beauty. The English world places, no, here we have the RYB system of designating three-phase wires, but then this is obviously German, where they use the word UV and W. And you see here already it is pre, I would say, indicated or coded or something. So all sorts of options are available. And then the main thing here is, it's not as if you push a bare wire into this. You have matching terminations which are crimped onto the wire, and then it is pushed inside. So this is typically one of those beautiful systems. Similarly, I'll go back again. Retention screw which holds the wire in place, and the modular connectors on the sides of the individual units, and blah blah blah, and all that. So if you go to any of these trade catalogs, they are almost interchangeable, because the pitch is fixed. And then there are enough techniques about how to assemble it onto the printed circuit board. And then there are multiple very, very complicated stacked things. 3-level is fairly common. 1 and 2 is normally used. 3-level also is available, meaning you have level 1, level 2, level 3. So 3 of the things which you can do. They are very useful for panel builders. Those big electrical control panels, invariably you have wiring ducts, it's a cable tray. So you take all the wires, and then there's a designation, and finally, depending on if it's a power thing, you, if it's a power carrying conductor, you need to terminate in a proper dowel and then push it inside and tighten it. In the case of normal PCB things, it's not that critical. But then good preparation is a must. As they have explained, it should not be hanging one in the air. We have all seen this. I do not know the reason why it is called a banana. This is made to plugs, crimped, sprung metal plugs and so on, available in a stackable that can easily be connected. You see here, this is the beauty of it. The thing is, if you are to provide a connector like this at the end, if you are to make it anything which can take multiple sizes and all, the chances of its failure a little high. And once it fails, the whole equipment needs to be repaired. Instead, on the other side, if you use this type of a floating contact which is also split, we have a very good chance of replacing it. All you need to do is, I'm sure you have seen these various other things, you just need to discard it and buy a new one, and then rarely you repair it. And then you see, ingenuity has made that we can insert another plug here, or we can insert another plug here, and it goes on like this without anything. And then you see the beautiful combinations of, there is a crocodile clip. We are getting very organic. We talk about bananas and crocodiles. Oh, sorry. This part of the world I am familiar with crocodile. Probably it is called alligator. Are good for test connections to post for bare wires. Easily cause short circuits nearby bare metal and all that. With all that risky business of, if you have this alligator teeth, make sure that it doesn't touch each other. Though they do come with a safety shroud here, okay, to make this visible. An opened one is given here. This is not how it is used, just only to show you how it is used. Two very good, a very nice thing you need to observe here is, first of all, it can grip well, okay. There is a beautiful spring here which is a little similar to the cloth specs that you have. And then on the other side, there is a nice crimping system available. And This also come with the shroud. You have seen this. The shroud will ensure to make sure, as I have explained here, wire terminated with the alligator clip for electrical test, the plastic boot surrounding the alligator to make it less likely to short to other connections. And if it is a something which is used for normal testing, generally they are made with probably silicone or other materials which flex easily without snapping. A little more expensive, but compared to PVC, while they are a little costlier, is more flexible. But in wiring, generally they have other materials. Loosely, I am using the word wiring, PVC, but I expect that lot of modification has taken place, and even the wires that is used in house wiring are not simple. So, again, continue having a look at it. Oh, I do not know if it is still used after the emulators and all have come. We have the beautiful small hooks. We can put the hook. You press here, it is a little like the pickle pickers or stuff which we occasionally use for holding something which is deep down. You press something, and for more delicate probing operation, there are a variety of IC clips. These are sized to allow a user to clip them onto the pins of an IC without contacting. Just smaller clips can be found on logic analyzer, test leads and so on. Likely that you have come about it. And then now we come to the beautiful RJ, modular connectors, a standard for telecommunications equipment into a local exchange. Normally here sir 45 and RJ 12. So generally you have seen this here. When they say RJ45, it means it is an 8 position 8 conductor modular jack. It implies that it is wire for Ethernet. Advantage of wire for Ethernet is that anything will fit anything else. So, if you have a laptop or if you have any of these devices, if you have the matching patch cord, things fit actually very well and they work. So, we have all these combinations of, this is what I was trying to tell you, is it? Oh, left one is the one how it shows bare, and this is the one how it goes inside. I thought I will tell you up front, but then it is already written there, because some of the time there are special small circuit elements which may have this, though I have not come across this thing as much, because most of them are the passive devices what we have. Some of them have cross connections. Understand, that is, if you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1 and 2 repeats 1 and 2. In other place, 1 and 2 are interchanged on the other side. So, the transmit and receive can work. This is a matter of detail. This thing is related to these connectors. Only thing is, like all other things, the total number of insertions and all are not very high. This is what I was trying to mention to you yesterday. This is called the type D sub miniature connectors, are a classic standard in the computer world. So, you have 15, 25, 15 and 9. The pin number indicates the number of connections provided, it indicates the size of the shell. DE and D9 have the same shell, different number of contacts and so on. So, usually 9 and 25 are about the common. Many desktop computers still include one serial port and can one parallel port. Terminated with connectors are widely available, and so on and so on. Main advantage is, it is not meant for power. repurposing of the cables be done cautiously as a non-standard device plugged into a this thing. What they mean repurposing is, if you attempt to rewire them by assigning a different purpose compared to what is the original standard. Like I said, if you take the side of my PC has a 3-row, I think 15 pin RGB, I think 3 rows. It is fairly standard. So as far as possible, in case you are really assigning the pins and all that, make sure that you don't damage something on the other side, which you find occasionally. Occasionally you find that somebody brings a laptop. Laptops are safe because they are all, you know, standardized. They bring a small black box. Laptop is admitted in the black box, and then the black box gives output saying this is a something something sharer and all that. Be careful. You try it out first and read the manual in case they have given one, or in case it is written in a special language. Ask the person who has used it whether his projector and his laptop continue to work, because unwittingly or unknowingly people, you know, interchange the pins and we end up with a problem. So we have, this is a beauty. I'll give you this link. It is from the sparkfun.com. I find it very comprehensive. It is as good as reading a textbook. But since these have, you know, been done parallelly, common textbooks are difficult. International Electrochemical Society has a couple of textbooks on this, which, you know, a little more advanced this thing, saying why what material and so on. So we have all this beautiful stuff here, and I'll stop it here at this point. We'll come to other people who have written about it. So leave all the main thing is why I have avoided trying to write again which is already written is that like all other books, in utero original. So obviously basic concepts is that the plug and socket, and when you choose a connector, number of pins is critical. I will go one step further, saying before you decide, check whether your other end or the other mating end of it, no, already has some standard or industry practice what they use. One lone example I have given you is the so called connector to connect your projectors and all this, for that RGB connection. And now these days slowly everything is being changed to digital, and then in the case we have the HDMI connectors, and then in between so many other standards. Some of your audio equipment, you would have seen even an optical cable. Some reason it didn't pick up. Maybe it is just like the VHS versus beta formats. Now both are not there anymore. So first thing, when you want to select a connector, first thing you just check whether what is it that is commonly used. I won't say it's an industry standard. I'll say common practice is very, very, very critical. Saying what do others use. Secondly, a few more pins are not bad. So you'll be surprised to see basic serial communication. What we see probably requires only two, and then for some technical reason we have 3 pins. You don't need too many of them. But then if you go to the industry where the instrumentation and such things are there, they invariably use the current driven connections, and then you have the hard standard. So HART standards are quite different, and then their own terminations, everything have been already defined. So the one simple easy way out is leave the cable and then give a designation, write somewhere how it is to be connected, and a trained person will not do a mistake. Alternatively, you need to take action. So necessary to determine how many pins will be required, they may not determine the actual connector part, but if the series of connectors can be used, particular connector, it is standard practice to ensure that spare pins for any future unforeseen circumstances requirements. If you want to increase current carrying capacity, all that you need to do is share to adjacent pins. You are in absolutely, you know, you are in good luck. So the current, at least initially, when the contact resistances and all are about the same, they will be shared automatically. This is often, no, number of insertions and mechanical considerations are still a problem. All connectors have a finite life. They will vary each time they are connected and disconnected. Often the life of a connector is specified in terms of the number of mating cycles. I suggest you read it yourself. So, connector, while basically the electrical requirement is about passing current and then withstanding a certain voltage, and then other things is how much drop you can have and so on and so on, something which often we probably ignore, not ignore, equal attention has to be paid off is the number of insertions. If you are in the lab, you may not foresee how many times it is inserted or not. We are all very familiar with the relay contacts. We are also a little familiar with the power connectors which you use for plugging in that thing. But other electrical, somebody has to have an audit of the choice of connector. So me being the packaging or somebody in the packaging field, I suggest, you know, you ask somebody who is there, and number of mechanical size, shape and so on, and then finally special electrical connector requires screening to be contiguous through the connector, or for the more exacting, the connector forms part of an RF feeder. The connector may need to be coaxial in nature, where the two conductors are manufactured so that one surrounds the other. There is something called the characteristic impedance of coaxials. So you have 50 ohm, 60 ohm and 75 ohm also. So the moment you exceed I feel around 1 megahertz, you end up with having to use matched terminations along with the matched cables. Luckily for us, for each aspect, we have standards, and then generally things are under control. Obviously, cost is a criteria, and then low cost sometimes ends up as cheap. Unlike audio, where there's a little bit of fashion also, gold contacts. Is a gold contact better than nickel plated? I'll say yes and no, but not in all places. A lot of times the gold plated contacts which they give a sell in audio is probably more as a fashion statement and less as a electrical requirement. So kindly hold back. It's for you to check whether it is. There's enough blogs are there saying whether they're required or not, but the reality is, depending on the application and the thing, the plating, the what you call the cost, no, are important things. Now coming back, is the current capability. Well, all the time we are thinking about shape, number of contacts and all that, the current carrying capacity is very important, though we may not appreciate how critical it is, because small, you know, things add up a lot. Even small things like, you know, milliamps eventually add up into hundreds of milliamps, and the moment anything crosses around 100 milliamps, already we come in little sticky situations, because all the connectors that stuff what I have shown you, the smaller ones are not capable of taking hundreds of milliamps. Only the power things, the cables which have no have actually copper conductors, 7 copper conductors and all that are capable of taking it. So, at this point, you see here, if current of a few milliamps or microamps are to carried, we have this stuff of a good quality connector is used. Low cost varieties may form oxide layers that need a certain level of current to flow, a good resistance. So, we still have this issue of the correct electrical material interface, gold to gold and so on. And a reasonable example of a bad contact is we are talking about the remote control things, and then often toys, especially remote control. You see, they have to use a spring at the back, and the cells that we use inside have a tendency to leak. So, that is a real reasonable, you know, condition for things which do not work properly. So, we have this stuff about contact sharing current, large overall margin. So, if you need to carry say 500 milliamps, and then normally by definition that contact can take only 400, probably two of them will work, and while both of them may not take 250. So, even if it is 200 and the other 300, your overall thing is maintained. Then voltage capability, above a certain voltage is not safe to operate a connector. This is obvious, you being electrical people or anybody is there. So, voltage is well known about it, though there is a small, often people talk about it. How can AC be a voltage? AC is a current, is it not? To have current flowing, you need a voltage, and voltage is from end to end, but between two terminals there can still be a large voltage difference. So, one example is the mains connectors which I have shown you. Over here we have a 230 volt system, the peak of it comes to 390 volts. So, any time two of the pins may be seeing around that almost 390, root 2, around 300 volts between two of the pins. If it is a 3 phase, they may be seeing that 400 volts. So, we still have a lot of voltage business here. We will never think of it when we just plug in a connector at the back of our computer, including all these power adapters and so on. Voltage capability, next very important or critical thing is the insertion force. So, I will see if I can pick one of the connectors I have here and show you. You see, this is taken from my computer which I am trying to see. You see here, it looks relatively safe, is it not? We have just two pins here, and we just need to put the mains, and I have explained to you somewhere else. Usually this end they make like this, so that you can use a cable which is shorter or longer. Other side the pins may be different, and this may be 110 volt or 230 volt device. This end is generally molded, okay, so that we do not accidentally, because other point is invariably they are all 19 volts, and this would say 100 watt per supply, more than 5 amps it will be carrying. This side is not so much. But the thing you see, this is expected to carry 230 into that peak voltage here. that's a lot of voltage, and some of them have a capacitive input, some of them have other things, so that accidentally on load if you connect or disconnect, there may be sparking here, which will happen. You may not intentionally pull it out, but when you pull it out, chances are there. So it gives here saying so many something something input is at 100 volts 1.5 amps, but then at output it is 5 amps, 20 volts and 5 amps. That is a lot of current passing through essentially a thin cable. The other end of the thin cable is terminated in one of these things. You see here, it looks simple, but a lot of thought has gone into it. You can't ignore the amount of thought that has gone into that. So if you go further, the insertion force seems to be critical. We can control voltage and current and so on, there is no issue about this voltages and currents because it is manageable. But the insertion forces and those things are not that well known. And as luck will have it, sometimes tremendous force is required. Imagine you have a connector which has 96 pins. Or you have 24 pins and so on and all that, and then you have a motherboard at the back, motherboard, and then you have plug-in cards. That's a lot of force, and motherboard is far away, and then the chances are it will flex. I mean, it will what you call flex. So if you take DIN 41612 or DIN 41617, lot of 31 pins is normally average. So even 64, 62 pins are also there. So each pin, even if you put a few grams, the insertion force becomes very, very high. Insertion force is a very critical issue here. So the problem with the insertion force is that while forcing, it goes inside because you have a pin here and then other side you have a socket, and then there is obviously something. This design of the way it is made looks look very, very, very critical. I showed you the electrical, you know, DIN type of a socket yesterday, meaning there is a housing which does the guiding. Pins themselves only take a small wiping action. The moment it goes inside, due to heating, it should not jam fully. So, unmating, that is removing it back also no, is equally critical. So somebody has worked okay, for many small connectors not a problem, for larger connector types with a large number of pins, the force per contact is multiplied by the number of pins used, result in a large amount of force being required to connect and disconnect. This can be a problem in some instances, may need to be considered where very large number of pins are required. Because right now this ZIF and all is probably out of fashion. At one time there used to be a connector what do you call a header used for putting ICs, everything, where you operate a lever on one side and then it opens, you push it inside and close it. They are a little out of connection now. So the thing is, in case they are simple flat connectors, they behave one way. In case it is circular, you need to have a proper key, that whole shell need a key. This is where the MIL or the mill standard connectors come. There is a circular thing, there is a key in which a keying thing is there, and then the connectors can have various type of dimensions. Once you push it inside, usually there is a screw or a bayonet on the outside which locks it in place. I will try to get a few samples. So we have already shown you about the so called DIN. Then we have this D type I have shown, and then DIN 4162, we do not see it very often, but what is called the Euro card, single Euro and double Euro card, which is part of the 19 inch rack system, they used to have this. Next we have the professional audio or XLR connectors, advantage being that all professional equipment, there is a there is something very, how to tell, exotic about it. The function is expected to be, nothing should ever happen, meaning whether it is a lip sync going on the screen or, you know, actually it is a professional presentation, there cannot be an interruption anywhere. On the other side, the chances of misuse and mishandling is very high. That is how this thing called the, you know, XLR connector started coming up. So we have a lot of this stuff about, you know, some D-type connectors, mechanical numbering, and then so on, and there are a large number of stuff about IEC power connectors. I suggest you read it yourself. Go to the electronics notes and then read yourself. So anyway, the picture could not be given here. You would have seen this. I will just stop here related to this. There are just too many of them here. I will try to go back to this little bit of this industrial PCB contacts which are stackable, and one of them is this Phoenix people. Now it is almost universal. Advantage of it is, unlike purely communication equipment, wherever you have industrial panels, these are used invariably, because as I told you, we have a cable tray, wiring is taken through it and then individually terminated, because no two panels are same. So we have so many of these things here. In this case, you see here that we have this nice way off. These are very small, these are miniature, little big. So we have a huge advantage of this. How to terminate them, how to make them, and so on. Now we come into feed through terminal box, because on one side we have wires being terminated, another side we have another wires being terminated. So you have a system that is again built up of a small thing, like for example, you have a contactor, then you have IO boards in a PLC, programmable logic controller. We end up with this fit through terminal box. So you have a bulkhead or a something, on one side you terminate, another side you take it off, with maintaining all these contacts. So I am just about running out of time, so maybe I should speed it up a little, okay. We have, you have seen, very large number of this is what I was trying to tell you about. So whenever I was talking to high reliability compliant with international things, you see here, even if you see the inside of the contact, we have the plug part, then we have the socket part, which this is also neatly split here along the length, it is split here. So we have one contacting here, one more contacting here. Make sure that all conditions, things will work. And this is the, remember that row of four finger contact construction, that is we have machined pins which will go inside. This is where I was talking to you about, it is much way beyond the normal thing. So we have a large number of these headers and things which are part of the any of the catalogs. So we have a huge number of this sort of things you would have seen probably on your connectors and all. I will close this window and come into a beautiful reliable contacts which have probably come from professional, I do not like the word war effort, but I will say aerospace, where cost is not the prime criteria, cost is the last criteria. So over the years, maybe just about the war time, these SMA connectors have been you know, standardized and invented like this. So, we have this on the other side, huge amount of about orientation, impedance, huge amount of things are available. SMA interconnects offer a precise, so on, and you see here 18 gigahertz, it is almost like microwave plumbing. So, and you see the amount of detail that has you know gone inside. There is a ferrule like thing here, I mean what do you call a rough surface, and then when you push it onto the other mating connector, it is there, and then the small cap here goes at the back of this, so that the soldering and all can be done, and you have so many of them, meaning it is just too big. Type SMA and then whatever you want is available there. And you see the, if you look at the mounting features, this is what I was trying to tell you yesterday about the bulkhead mounting, front mounting, rear mounting, edge mounting. So, I will see as the windows open, see we have a beautiful connector here up to 26.5 gigahertz. Seen here, there are 4 pins which mount nicely on the PCB. There is something which can be mounted with 2 holes, straight jack, solder cup. See the back termination, there is a solder cup. Using precise controlled dispenser soldering, you can just put one the inside of the cable and it gets terminated here. Then you have 50 ohms, then this is one with mounted with 2 flanges. Seen this, this is a beauty. You just cannot think of a better thing. Further go down. Flange with 4 pins. I am not very clear as to why it is. Maybe they are just parallel standards. And well, they exist. They are there very much. So, we have a round post, straight plug and you know all of them. You see here, invariably there is a socket here with a thread on the outside. So, the cable comes with the other end of it. So, at the back if you see, straight jack, panel mount, and they have a beauty of a right angle mount also, SMA right angle mount. So, we have a huge number of these with the square flange. This is what I was trying to tell you about bulkhead mounting. If you look at the way there is a continuous thread on both sides. Obviously, depending on the position of the flange and all that, and depending on this mating thing, these are all mounted from outside a bulkhead. So, if you have a flat plate here, the connector goes here and then you tighten it at the back and you can continue with the whatever stuff you wanted to do at the back. Okay. So, we have beautiful round post at the back and the thread is continued and so on. After you see the next picture, probably you will understand. You see here, we have something else here completely. So, at the back a different style of mounting is there, at the front it is like this with a cable 50 ohms, and then depending on where the washer is and then how do you mount it, you have a choice of mounting it behind the panel. The moment you mount it behind the panel, you see here there is a little bit of packing given here and then all this stuff is there at the back, and then you see here you have a washer. These things will make sure that you can, anything you want, you probably have already something which is built inside, expensive but available there. So, many more options. See the small option, one of them is you have a PCB. The ones are about something is stuck on top of the PCB, you can put a connector, or you terminate it here and then you have a cable and then that cable goes and sits into this and then you can take something out. then sometimes you cannot afford to have this extra additional this thing, was any time there is a joint and something has to be threaded and so on, there is a tremendous loss of signal and the signal integrity is lost. So, you have special connectors here, you have seen that PCB jack, you have seen this end launch PCB jack. So, if you design the PCB carefully, it is possible for you just insert it and then put it through various soldering techniques. We have something which suits extremely well. If you think about it, a professional company has thought about it and given you things which, you know, which are soldered here and so on, which I feel, no, it is a real wonder. So, we have including making things work fast, press fit. So, you can push the, you know, a press fit jack, which ensures that it just sits inside. And why this is required is occasionally you end up with a machined housing which you have no access for playing around with various types of assembly and so on, especially in the case of microwave and all that. There is not too much of thing you can do, it just has to work properly, and the chances are you will never be playing around and desoldering or anything. So, you have this module, you assemble the whole thing together, and sometimes the whole thing is even together, it is put on a special type of some hydrogen brazing or something they call. In those conditions, they use these press fit panel mount jacks. So, if you go on, we have all these, you know, large number of types of cables type of thing, and then if you see the important part is high temperature, shock and corrosion, and mill standard MIL STD. That is the reason they are costly, but generally off the shelf they are not as expensive as a full fledged qualified thing. If it is a full qualified tested thing with a test certificate, it still continues to be costly, but you have for various things, you have a beautiful thing by which, you know, you can check saying, but you see here still we still have this little problem. Number of mating and unmating cycles still limited, 500 is not too much of it, but generally it is unlikely that you will exceed it because it is inside some other bigger equipment. Eventually outside it will be terminated by an antenna connector or something which is a power connector and so on. It is unlikely you will ever end up with making all these things. Then connector affixment, crimp style, solder styles, reverse polarity, beautiful, okay. Flexible cables up to about 10 gigahertz and then semi-rigid up to 8. You have the important thing, this thing, I think probably, you know, we are coming slowly towards the end. I feel happy that this is the plug and jack dimensions which are actually the standard. Understood, no? Standard meaning, you have seen this here, 0.051, this is written in inches. I am not familiar with inches, but I expect that it is, I mean, something appropriate conversion. Thing is, any of this jack and any of this plug is expected to mate reliably without losing that impedance, characteristic impedance of 50 ohms, and then without violating the voltage and current requirements from any other manufacturer. So, all manufacturers, this part of it they maintain as a interface standard, which I feel it's very, very good. Seen this? In fact, there are some which have all sorts of stuff here. I think this must be enough for a lecture. I will try to stop here and see whether I can insert or show you some pictures of our equipment which uses these small components. Then something a little related is the MCX connectors. I will see with all this confusion, I will be able to hit on the MCX connectors on the web today. Bear with me. These are tiny, 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 as in really, really, really tiny. So, you find this occasionally inside micro coaxial. So, compared to SMA, it comes to the SNB, and then this TNC is what I was talking to you about. So, you see here, they are really tiny. You would have seen some of these. If you have worked with mobile phones and such places, it is really tiny, and then that part which is mounted on the printed circuit board, it is you have to see it. I do not have a drawing because of the thing, I should not give you the thing here. Main thing being, it is small, extremely small. Both you have 50 and 75 ohms, and occasionally or very rarely have seen 60 ohms also. They are tiny, 3.6 millimeters is the nominal diameter. 3.6 is very tiny, really, you know. So, this is where the MCX, and then in MCX, while the interface has been maintained, the outer dimensions have been even made smaller. So, I will see if I can hit something here. You see here, really, really tiny things. It is a micro coaxial. I think at this point, unless I show you some typical examples, allow me to stop here and get back. So, if you can think it, there is probably a connector available, and then you should never try to compromise on it. On the tabletop or in your test bench, things work, and the moment you change the configuration a little, chances are it will get out of hand. To prevent it, I feel we need to use the professional connectors, even if you are to make one unit for demonstration. I am for, you are trying to spend more than money, the effort and things and all that, and over the time, if your lab can stock all these items, you will be a professional engineer. So, thank you. I will see how well I can continue next time, because the connectors is too vast and there is no way I can do justice by giving a simple talk about it. So, thank you.